friends, how are you? Woo! All right, thank you so much for sticking around in the evening and having so much fun with us today at Microsoft Ignite. I am Scott Hanselman.
And my name's Mark Downie.
And Mark and I are going to talk about all the stuff that you've been seeing today and try to put it into a little bit of context, because I think that there's everything is a copilot, right? And now you're going to have to go home and you're going to have to explain to non-technical mom and dad what the heck's going on. I've had to have my mom call me and say, do I want the AI? Is the AI in the room with me now? Is the AI going to hurt me? She hears about the actor strike in AI. She wants to know if it's a virus. Does she need to remove the AI? Then Alexa's saying stuff. Why is Alexa not smarter? A lot of questions happening around AI. People are saying that it's going to change everything, but we're not really sure how it's going to change everything. And the important thing to understand is that we're just getting started. This is a new user interface. We're spending time figuring out where buttons go on the screen, but we also need to figure out, how do you talk to your computer? It's not a person. Should you talk to your computer? Should you treat it like a human? Should you be kind to it? Should we name them? These are all things we need to figure out. That's the interface with our computer. When iPhones came out and touch screens came out, we had to relearn how to do this. We're in the process as a community of relearning how these copilots are going to work, aren't we?
Right.
All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into my machine here and pop into the OpenAI playground. I want to point a couple things out here. This system message inside of the OpenAI playground, and for non-technical people in the room, this is where you would spend time if you were going to start to train a chatbot to talk about a subject. It might talk about your museum or your topic of interest. If you are an author and you've written 10 books, you could feed your books into the assistant and then interview it, and it would now become an assistant that knew everything about your topic. This particular assistant in this tool here in the OpenAI playground only knows that it is a helpful assistant. But you don't see that. As the user of the thing, you are just assuming that the agent is going to be helpful, right? So if I go to this assistant and I ask it something like, I need a taco recipe, we have to ask ourselves, how does it know? How does it know anything about food? How do I know that the recipe is not going to kill me? Like, we have questions. There's no kitchen to test that recipe. How does it know what the next thing to do is? If I drop into this complete section here in the playground, I'm going to go down in the lower right corner, and there's a section that's marked Show Probabilities. And this really showcases that when you talk to an AI, you're not talking to an intelligence. You're talking to something that picks the next likely word. Now, yes, this is an oversimplification, but that's what analogies do. Now, I've been married for 25 years, and you just had your 25th anniversary.
I certainly did.
Not married to each other, just a coincidence. 25 years.
Yes, 25.
And does your wife know what you're usually about to say?
Most of the time.
Okay, you surprise her sometimes.
Rarely.
Rarely, right. Because you've known each other so long, for a quarter of a century, you finish each other's...
Sandwiches.
Sandwiches, exactly. So if we were to go to this artificial intelligence here and turn on the full spectrum of possibilities, that we're going to actually see something, and I'm going to say, it's a beautiful day, let's go to the, what is the next thing to say? What's your wife going to say the next word is?
We went to the museum.
The museum,
right?
Right? So this is effectively AI as Family Feud. Right? Steve Harvey's here. It's a beautiful day. Let's go to the show me beach. Show me park. What's the right answer? Let's find out. Park. This is where I need the non-technical people, the business development people to understand. Is that answer right? Is Steve Harvey's answer right? If it's the first answer, is it right? No, it's most likely to be the next answer. That doesn't even mean it's the most likely to be the right answer. It's just the next one. Let's click on this because we turned on full spectrum, and look at that. So now, if I say, as a user of AI, as a data scientist, as a prompt engineer, which I've now added to my LinkedIn, I'm sorry, Mark, you're wrong. Museum is wrong.
It's what we did.
It's what we did.
It's what we do.
Because it's right for you.
Right.
So then, why is museum not there at all? What are we missing?
Some context.
We're missing some context because we're missing 25 years of relationships, of time spent together, of the things that you do.
Right.
I'm here with my friend Mark. He's from London, period. His wife and he love going to the museums and they love art. Oops. Okay, I'll spell that correctly. And let's see if that context provides any value here. Whoa.
Right.
Yo, they love you. The right. AI loves you. This is amazing. Look at that. Modern art. Is this a real thing?
It is. Tate is a real modern art museum.
It's a British thing.
Yes, yes. Actually, I haven't been to that one.
You haven't been? Still, hang on. Did the AI just provide value to you? And you're
absolutely.
Like, we have not gone 25 years. Never been to the Tate right. Art Museum. Isn't that brilliant? Look at these different colors. It's saying it might have suggested other museums.
Yeah.
Once it said Tate, modern suddenly became more,
right.
More reasonable. And then art is red. It was considering punctuation. I mean, what's going on here, Mark?
So my assumption here is that every single word you're getting, imagine you're sending somebody a text, right? And it starts to autocomplete for you. That next word may be useful based on what it's seen from everyone else, but for you, it may not actually be the right thing. That's why we end up sending each other those terrible texts that make no sense because the percentages didn't work for your situation. And so this is every time we see some red, we're starting to see something that's less likely that's happening or more likely as the case may be. So you've got to think about this as every single thing you, context you provide kind of gives you a percentage on what it might be in the next word.
Exactly. So if we return back to the recipe theory, remembering that the only context it has is you are helpful.
Right.
Then what it's going to do is it's going to look around what's called the corpus. The corpus is the thing that you trained it on. And in this case, the OpenAI very large language model is trained on all the text on the internet. And this is really important because the internet is 49% a joy and 49% pure evil and 2% that haven't decided which side they're on yet. And what'll happen is if you are cruel, if you are unkind, if you are mean, if you are impatient, if you say mean things to the AI, the next word will be mean, cruel, and unkind. This is not a joke, and it is still not a person. But if you say nice things, if you compliment the AI, you're going to end up pulling from the nice parts of Stack Overflow and Google and Bing and the places where people are pleasant.
Right.
So I need a taco recipe right now, and you're helpful, are going to bring me a delicious and easy taco recipe. Okay? It's picking words that are near taco on the internet. But if I said something like, you're a belligerent assistant, a lot like Benedict Cumberbatch as Sherlock Holmes, period. You're not super happy to be here, comma, and you're gonna give me what I need, but you're not gonna be thrilled about it, period, and you're a little bit sassy. Okay? So now, I've given it context. Now remember, you, the audience, cannot see that. You've just showed up on Scott's website and asked for tacos. Oh, wonderful, another banal request for a recipe. Sorry, I apologize on behalf of England.
No, knock yourself out.
Yeah. Oh, taco shells, soft or hard, it won't hinder. Oh, this is just mean. It's very quite cruel here. Look at this. Your lack of preference won't hinder my guidance. Here's a recipe I can't promise it'll be stimulating as a true challenge for the intellect. It's a rather simple and mundane task. Suddenly, it's rude. It will be a different flavor of rude depending on the prologue. The point being, look at that, how utterly common. We don't see that. I programmed that. I told it to be unkind.
Right.
When we interact with people, we always say the first impression is important. Someone's like, you know, I met this guy at the hotel lobby yesterday. Didn't really like him. Not really feeling Hanselman, not a nice guy. Maybe I had a bad day. Maybe I didn't have the 3 Diet Cokes that I need to wake up in the morning. There's lots of reasons why I might have a bad first impression. Presumably after 25 years of marriage, having each been renewed for another season,
we
have made a good enough impression that our wives tolerate us, right?
For one more season, yes.
Yeah, for at least one more season. This is important because our wives have that context, mm-hmm. and that new person is still building context. And context is so fundamental when you are interacting with a co-pilot, whether it be a Microsoft Office one or a Visual Studio one. Now, we've got some developers here, we've got some non-technical people here, we've got some IT folks here. But I know we like to see secret things from inside Microsoft, right? We like to see stuff that's never been seen before, correct? You have some hot bits.
This stuff's new.
Now, this means that this is fresh off the developers' computers.
Right.
This is not released. Is it an experiment? Is it a preview? Where is this?
So this is going to be a preview soon.
Okay.
This preview's coming out really soon. So the bits I have will be coming out really, really soon.
Okay. So we're going to show you something that does not currently exist. I'm going to let Mark take over, and we're going to see some things where we have Copilot, GitHub Copilot, plugged into Visual Studio. For the non-technical people in the audience, of course, Visual Studio is like Microsoft Word for programmers. It's the place where we write the stuff, and then when we ship it, if you write a script, you ship it into Word, and if you write a program, you ship it from Visual Studio, but it's just text, right? It's just text.
Yep. So I'm actually going to try out asking Copilot to help me with a set of programming problems. Actually, I'm an open source developer. I've been doing open source for many years now. In fact, I took over a project that Scott used to shepherd quite a long time ago. What I'm going to do with this is see if I can get it to fix a few of the issues that we've had open for a while. In fact, what I have open right now is the issues section of GitHub, where all our open source code resides.
These are bugs, right?
Right. These are bugs that, or enhancements that folks want as part of the blogging engine. They want it to be a little bit better. And what we try to do here is create a scenario where if I create a blog post and I add an image into that blog post, I want that to be the hero image. Now, naively, this was originally implemented to just pick the first image, but I want it to be explicit. I want to say that image is the one I want for my blog post. Let me show you what I mean by that. So this is my blog post here, my blog right here. I'm going to pick a blog post. And just so happens that this image is the only image, so it'll pick this one. But if there were three images, it would just pick the first one anyway, and it could be a GIF, a silly GIF, and that's not what I want as the hero image, right?
Okay, so I write a blog, I've got three or four pictures, and you're gonna pick the best one, and it'll become the front, the hero.
Yeah.
But you're gonna do that programmatically, and this doesn't exist in DOSBlog
today. Does not exist today.
Okay.
In fact, this has been open for 2 years. You can see no one wanted it, no one touched it. Things are usually fixed relatively quickly, but no one wanted it. I think it's because it's a regular expression problem.
And just as a point to Mark's credit, this is a blogging engine for writing a blog. It's called DOSBlog, which is German for the blog. This was actually written by Clemens Vasters,
right,
and then myself, and then Mark has taken over as a shepherd, and it's all open source. So all the code that we're showing you can see, it's completely free and open.
All right, so this is the first method. This is a function in a extension class, and this is how we grab that first image, right? So as you start, as a kind of new contributor, you may ask yourself, well, what is this method doing? And I kind of like the idea of asking in a conversational way, using Copilot to ask, and I'm gonna hit Alt slash, and that will bring up a little inline prompt. And I can simply do actually a slash command, and if I tab down.
I wanna zoom in on that.
Yeah.
So I wanna point out that he's writing his code, right? Just like when you're writing a Word document, you have a comment that appears inline. He's made a little inline mark there. He can go and ask it questions, and slash explain, you're basically saying explain, but how does it know what to explain?
So it's sitting in the context right now. So the thing we were establishing right at the start here is that without context, it's just going to do anything it wants. The probabilities are going to be completely uncertain. What we want to do is establish context. If you don't establish context, you essentially get more random and more random suggestions. So let me go ahead and hit enter and see what it comes up with.
Right, and this context is a kind of grounding. You're grounding it in the thing. You're trying to get it focused. Remember that we see folks taking ChatGPT and OpenAI and writing limericks and do this in the form of Shakespeare. None of those things are interesting. He is saying, tell me what's going on in this code. It still has the power to do limericks and Shakespeare, but that's not what we're doing. He's grounding it in a reality,
right,
which is explain what's going on in this code.
So this already knows I'm a C# developer. Like, I don't have to set that context anymore. And it's given me a pretty good answer here. It said this is a method that's in a string extension class. It's told me the name of it and what the information, it's the parameter it's using. It's basically saying there's a regular expression in here. So it's read all of that detail about my code and is able to share it with me. So one of the things I used to do when I was a developer at first was literally write out the explanation of the method. This kind of sits within that kind of practice, right, of learning, where you can get a natural language explanation of the scenario.
Absolutely. So much time is being spent focused on the what AI can generate, but not enough time is being spent on what it can do to summarize the TLDR, the too right. long didn't read.
Right.
That was effectively a technical writer just wrote you a chapter of a book exactly. about a function that might be unfamiliar.
Exactly.
That's what is going to change for the next generation of developers.
Yeah, open source developers now don't have to kind of spend those weeks gearing up. You can cut that time dramatically by simply asking. So I'm going to actually go a little bit further because it's a regular expression. And I don't know about you, but every single time I do a regular expression, it seems like the first time I've ever done a regular expression. So let's kind of see if we can break out what this regular expression is doing. I'm going to hit Alt slash again.
Right. The regular expression for the non-technical in the room on line 79 that looks like a swear word, like maybe it would be in a comic book with Snoopy, and just he's very upset with the little bird that's sitting on his thing. Those are actually, we have to write those like bespoke, and they're the worst.
Right. So let's go ahead and hit enter, see what it comes up with. So to situate, make sure it was in the right context, I put that on the right, on that line, right? That line, I'm telling it this is the regular expression by highlighting the line I'm interested in. Okay, I love this. So what's it shown here? It's shown it's looking for, here's the breakdown. It kind of does a breakdown, a regular expression. I'm looking for anything that starts with the image. It's looking for anything after that. And it's looking for something called SRC, which we know to be source of the image, right? It's breaking down each part of that regular expression. I think even with this information, I could probably write the regular expression again. But we're actually going to go a bit further than that, I think.
Absolutely beautiful. It's in plain English.
Yes.
It is so powerful to be explaining in plain. It's an infinitely patient person spending time with you. Unlike if I call Mark in the middle of the night on a Sunday, and I go, Mark, help me understand this regular expression. He's,
right.
Hanselman, stop calling me. This is not programmed to do that. It will be infinitely patient.
Yeah, we have grounded the responses here. So you don't have to worry about that part, right? Ultimately, we want to make sure that it is a helpful assistant and not Benedict Cumberbatch. So
that we love, Benedict, if you're watching, sir.
Okay, let's just jump back out here. So what I want to do then, I want to do find first image, but I want to do find hero image in my example, right? So I'm going to go ahead and this is what I would normally do. I would start the kind of outline of this. I would change the
beginning
name.
Beginning to write a new method.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Hero image. And here I can again start asking questions with alt slash again. I'm going to say rewrite this method using a
while he's doing that,
regular
in coding, we are the bridge between the business person, I want the thing done, which business people usually speak English, or business people English, and they write it up in a Word document, and they email it to you, and then they go golf. And then we, the developers, are left to actually translate between English, prose, business solution, and turn it into some kind of code. What's amazing about something like Copilot is that in this case here, he is writing prose, very specific prose. He's giving a very specific instruction and hoping that will translate, that specificity will translate to another kind of specificity.
Right. Right. So I've said, just to kind of summarize, rewrite this method using a regular expression that checks the block content parameter, you can see right there on line 94, and returns the value of the source string, that's what we want, only where the class name is set to hero image. We want it to be very specific, not the first one. So
yes,
I'm going to go ahead and have that go. Now, probabilities apply, right? I don't know.
It might say museum. You don't know.
We just don't know.
Okay. How do you know if it's right, though? Because we just talked about how museum is right for you and you know, beach is right for me.
We have to test it. Ultimately, I don't trust anything this says. I mean, to be respectfully truthful here, I have to assume that it's like when I go to a blog post or go to Stack Overflow, it may be right for them, but it may not be right for me.
I'm just trying to, I want to make sure it's a little subtle. I just want to make sure we're clear. AI suggestions might be inaccurate. Why? AIs can't make tacos. It made a recipe.
Right.
We have no proof it's good tacos. You have to make the recipe. AIs can't code yet. And in this case here, we have to test it.
Right. So I'm going to go ahead and accept that. And we'll do a quick, I expect you'll do a thorough review, but I'm going to do a quick one here, standing here. Oh, I'm already seeing that it is kind of put my tabs not quite right. But let's compare it really quickly to find first image. So find a first image is here. And it has a variable find first image. It has a naming convention. It's doing its thing. Find hero image looks almost identical, right? Don't know if it's right yet, but it looks almost identical.
It looks
identical.
A little different there. You see
yes.
Hero image, yeah.
Yeah, you see class hero image. It understood the regular expression in find first image. And it, in fact, renamed the variables to look like hero image. So my code is sitting in this context, right? And it's been changed already, just like you would do if you went to Stack Overflow. You'd see some code, mm-hmm. and you say, that's almost right.
Right.
Let me pull it into the look more
but
like my
did
stuff.
It run it? Did it compile it? Did it test it?
Nope. That's all my job now.
That's your job.
Let's go do this. Let's do this. I'm going to go into profile post, and here I'm going to change find to find hero image there, and let's hit the start debugging.
So he hits the start debugging. For the non-technical, it's a little VCR button at the top with the little play. He's going to run this application with code that was just generated. You really have typed nothing but prose at this point.
I have not done anything.
Okay, so how will we know if it works?
We should see our image here, which we don't, okay? Mm. And that makes sense. Why? Because we haven't defined in whatever the source of this is as class equals hero image. Let's go back in really quickly. Let's do that.
Yes, sir.
So we want, and remember we're all XML files here, so we've got class equals
So he's got a blog, just like WordPress or your own websites or your blog. In this case here, it's using DasBlog. And in order to make this demo work, he's going to go and do this manually, but you would not ordinarily have to do that manually. But if the class is correct, we should see the image appear, which would mean that you didn't have to write any code.
And there it is. It picked up the idea that this class equals hero image. It's there. It did it.
Okay. But we talk about context. We talk about how the AI doesn't know 25 years of marriage. It doesn't know what I ate for breakfast.
Right.
It knows only what you tell it. And that context, those references, like if some kid turns in a 5-paragraph essay, I want to see references. I want to know where you looked those things up.
Right, right.
Let's see some things that no one's seen before.
Yeah, okay, let's move on. So you probably would have seen AI write code, AI read code. I actually like to move on to how it might help you debugging and diagnostics. This is my key area here. So we've been implementing with DasBlog the idea of activity pub standard, which is a way, hopefully, that we will allow blogs to kind of communicate within the Fediverse. So this standard is the way we do that. So I've been.
May I translate?
Please do.
So Twitter is awful, and there's another place. And the Fediverse, the Federated Verse, also called Mastodon, is an alternative social network. There's lots of social networks. And just like you've got Threads and Facebook and Instagram and all these different places, some of which have varying levels of awful, what you want to be able to do is you want to take the information on your website and syndicate it, just like Garfield writes a comic and it shows up in local newspapers. He's going to write his blog post, and he wants it to show up in the feeds of people on Mastodon and Twitter and all the different places, the collective federated universe, or Fediverse.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
So I'm going to dive in here with some diagnostics here. And what that really means is I want to test my code. I want to see if this new code that I've been creating is going to be helpful. And the way I can do that is by, in fact, I've got a HTTP file, which is basically a way for me to send a request to a particular endpoint so I can test bits of my blog to see if it meets the standard.
Would you mind if we just dug just into that just a smidge deeper, sir? Can we look inside there?
Yeah, sure thing. So this is a HTTP file. Again, this is kind of the variables here, but this is essentially me sending a get. Let me zoom in a little bit.
Yeah, let's zoom in on that.
So I'm sending a get to this URI, and you can see it's taken the variables here for the endpoint, and this is the header. The accept header is part of the header of that request.
So he's effectively simulating being a browser, simulating being like Postman, and he's basically doing this locally on his computer, And because his computer is not accessible from the internet, he's going to go and make a developer tunnel, allow that to be available to the outside. Those HTTP files are a way of doing kind of live testing.
Right, exactly. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and send that request. And what you're seeing coming up right here is called the exception helper.
Okay.
The exception helper is my way, or Visual Studio's way, of saying something unexpected has happened. And if you don't handle this correctly, it's going to mess with the part of the code that's running. This is all brand new to me, right? This is most of the code in here is dealing with creating files from objects and the vice versa, serialization, deserialization, what we know as that. And so this is a particular kind of error that I'm now going to have to track down. It's my responsibility to track that down.
Right. And in the movies and TV, there's a lot of glamour with a person slapping the keyboard, and they're like, I can see it. It's happening. And then another person sits next to them, and there's two people on one keyboard. Most of programming is doing this. Oh, yo, what do I do now? And then you stare at this for some number of hours.
Right.
This is broken. We are crashed. We are stuck on line 28, and it's 2 a.m., and our homework is due in the morning.
Right. Yeah, I'm at the top of the funnel. Anything could be going wrong right now. It's stopped here, but it could have been anywhere else. And hopefully what I'm going to show you today is some of the newest parts we've got thinking about how we can help you kind of shorten the possibilities of what might be going wrong with the code. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and ask Copilot. There's a brand new Ask Copilot button we have right there. I'm going to ask Copilot. Now, this is starting a conversation. Rather than just be in line, I've got a conversation happening here. And this conversation is being done for me. I've asked Copilot, and it's taken some context from my debugging and handed it and said, this is going to be helpful for exceptions.
And this is huge, because a lot of us and our interactions with ChatGPT, when we see demos, and everything is live, none of this is canned, to be clear, we don't do canned demos, is you ask the thing a question, and it gives you an answer, and then you marvel at how smart the AI is. This is not that. The AI is not smarter than us.
Right.
It's our helper.
Yep.
It's Copilot, not pilot.
It really doesn't know what it's going to do. We are going to be the ones who have to be the direction for this.
Right. But what is going on there?
All right. So inside there, let me go back in again. This is the references, the context it has passed to Copilot. In order to, the exception by itself, you can pretty much look that up. We got docs on that. Hmm? But in this situation, to understand what it really means, you're going to need things like the call stack. Where did this happen? You know, what happened before this? You need information about the exception, and you probably need to know something about the local variables in that particular situation. So we are being upfront. This is what we're sending when we have an exception we want to help you analyze.
So when I asked ChatGPT earlier about it's a beautiful day and where should we go,
mm-hmm.
I gave it context. I decided to say where you were from, how long you've been married, and what you enjoyed doing. I suppose it could have said, I don't know enough about you to say where we should go today.
Right.
So in this case here, we gave it some stuff as context. Is it smart enough to actually ask for more?
This is what we're working on most recently. I want to show you here. Okay, so it's gone through, and it's actually got a good description of got a pretty good description of what's going on here, but we actually really got that from the exception itself. What's interesting is that it reckons that it's something to do with a known type. There may be a few of you who know what that means here. I do not. And so what it's asking you for here is, if you give me just a bit more information, and it said, could you please provide the definition of user page view model, right? It knows about this because of the narrow context we've given it. It's saying that thing I need a bit more information on. I need more context.
Why didn't it just take it? Because it's all powerful and it sees everything and it knows everything. Why didn't it just take it?
And that's the thing. We've got to have this balance between what we are going to give you and mm-hmm. what you actually want to send.
Right.
And I think it's important for us to kind of be responsible at this moment, to think about the things that you want to share or don't want to share. Ultimately, that's a decision that, again, why this has to be a co-pilot. You're going to make that decision. You're going to say, what things do I want to send to Copilot? This particular file is full of secrets. Don't want that ever going. There's no good reason for that to go. You're going to be the one to kind of be in charge of deciding when it's going to be something else.
This is so important, what Mark is saying, that we are being intentional. And by we, I don't mean Microsoft. I mean we in this moment, in an AI moment, have to decide. You know those movies where Arnold Schwarzenegger wakes up and he's on Mars or whatever, but he's not on Mars? He wakes up and he goes over to the computer, and how do you know it's the future? Because he has a giant TV that's mounted. And it goes, hello, welcome. I analyzed your urine this morning, and your sugar's a little elevated, and I'm going to put in a call to your doctor, and by the way, your fridge doesn't have enough milk. I've ordered some milk for you. And we go, oh, the future's going to be great. That's super creepy, and we don't want that. If you sit down at your computer, we have the technology. We could write a program that looked at the webcam and said, you're looking a little peaked today, right? You should smile more, Mark. And you would say, wow, that's now entering uncomfortable.
Right.
So this user interface experience that you're developing with Copilots is not about the tech. It's about the humans. It's about the decisions. It's about the responsibility and the intentionality about what we're going to do. So you at the Copilot team are deciding, what should a pair programmer know, and how should it behave?
Right.
It could have taken it, but you chose not to let it take it.
Exactly. So I'm going to go ahead and continue with this.
We're in control 4 mode. There you go.
Okay, there we go. All right. So it's asked me, it says, could you get a bit more information? Sure you can. So I'm going to click on this. It's going to bring up this class. And if I could remember.
Shift, Alt, equal sign. No. So what he's going to do is he's going to do an expand selection. So what the AI has done is it's asked for more information. So he went to that place where the information is. He's expanding the selection contextually. And then look at this. I want to just zoom in on that for a second, if you wouldn't mind. I want to get that to pop up, if I may.
Yeah, please.
And then I want to show you. He can look at that. He can say, here are the things that I want to share. But look at the one there that says selection. I'm only going to give you from this line to that line, and I want you to look at that. And I'm going to say, this is the thing you asked for.
All right, let's go that.
So let's do that again live. Say, here's the selection from these lines.
Let's go.
And then we see that references again, showing the additional new information. And now it has more ideas for us. Wow, it doesn't have more ideas. It literally made a whole suggestion and said, go and write it like this. Yeah, you can hit Control 4 and come back out, sir.
All right, so here it's literally telling us, hey, we are missing this known type information from this user page view model. This is the reason why this broke in that way. I think I'm going to have an issue with my preview there, so I can copy and paste that into place. But ultimately, that's the problem, right? But it wouldn't have been able to get there without that additional context. So it's asking a question. It's the AI realizing, hey, we've got a theory, but we need to validate that. And the only way we can validate that is if we bring in more information. This conversational aspect is the very newest and latest parts that we've been working on here. And I've got one more example if we have some time.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing to point out here is that we want AI, as I've said before publicly, to be more like Iron Man and less like Ultron. Or Iron Man 3, for that matter, because Tony Stark was like flying around, but he was just chilling, and the Iron Man suits had nobody in them. Iron Man suits got to have people in them doing cool stuff. Otherwise, they're just scary robots. I want a co-pilot that is going to have a conversation with me. It's going to be patient. It's going to be kind. It's going to be helpful. And it's going to be that thing that I can turn to, that I can ask for advice. It's almost like having an infinite technical book. You could sit down with co-pilot and say, I want to learn HTML today and have a whole conversation. It'll walk you through it like a tutorial. And that's exactly what we expect from our systems. I don't want to say, write me a website from scratch. It'll be fine. Right. And then let it have the keys to the kingdom.
Right.
Okay, so what have we done, sir?
So I want to move on to the next area.
Yes, sir.
Because I think this conversational aspect is really an important way. This is the way you actually debug issues. You'll ask somebody, you'll ask that one person who's the smartest person in the room, and they'll get you the details you want. Mm-hmm. And maybe the answer they have is informed by what they were working on. However, your context is more important. So you don't just accept the thing they say. You have a conversation, and then you add a little bit more context, and they say, oh, seeing as you said that, let's do this, right? And so I want to kind of show how we're experimenting that with that again. So I'm going to run Test Explorer. Again, this code isn't very reliable. So I'm going to go ahead and zoom in here. I'm going to debug this particular code. It's a part of my test suite. And I'm going to see why it's crashing.
So then you hit Control 4.
Yeah, got it. Okay, so it's really just started running this test, and it's going to go ahead. And it stopped again. I have another serialization issue. This is another serialization issue I've created here. And I'm going to go ahead and ask Copilot. I want to notice on the right side, however, that it started a brand new discussion. Like, this is an actual multiple discussions. If I can show here by zooming in again, I now have three discussions that have been going on. The original thread that I came in with, mm-hmm. my previous exception, and now this new exception. And it's important to understand that each one of those is a separate conversation because I'm building on myself and I'm providing more context. If I was to dive into my previous conversation with this new context, it's going to basically ruin the original and the new conversation.
That's a really great point, because you're effectively got three support tickets
right.
opened with tech support.
Right.
And by giving them that context and saying, oh, no, this is about that other issue that I'm dealing with, I ground it in the focus of the now.
Yes, absolutely.
Because we all are juggling things, whether it be Microsoft 365 in a Word document or some email, or in this case, some code. We want to ground it in the work that I'm currently doing.
So this analysis, again, references we've sent, the same typical, same kind of thing. We are thinking about the call stacks. Call stacks is the list of methods I've called up to this point, the exceptions and the locals. And it's looked at this, and again, it's asking me for more information, right? It's looked back at the call stack and said, can you provide me a bit of information? There's a local variable that we don't have information because it's further up the stack.
This is really important, and this is really significant because it's saying, can you check the value? It didn't even say, give me the value. Check the value, because we don't want to send someone's social security number to
right.
Copilot.
Right.
We don't want PII, or personally identifiable information. So it's saying, I need to know if this is good or not, if it's empty or not,
right.
it's got questions. It's up to us to decide if we're going to send it to it, and even if it was sent, we wouldn't do anything with it. I like that it didn't just know.
Right, absolutely. So I'm going to go back up the call stack, further back, whatever method called this one, to see if I can get information here. And that serialized variable is right here, and I can simply hover over it and see that it's empty. So I'm going to say back to it the way it said to me, it's,
Do you have an extra little?
Serialized? The serialized variable, excuse me.
Is empty, okay.
Empty. All right, so I'm letting it know the information it's missing.
Look at that. Look at this. It's like, that's the issue. That's very confident, a little sassy there. That's the issue. I wish it would have been like, nailed it. You need to ensure it's not empty before you serialize it.
Interesting. Okay, this, I'm going to lean into here because this actually is incorrect. I would have taken this information and gone off on a direction that is actually incorrect. And I think we have to kind of, as we kind of all getting excited about what it is to use AI and what it is to make it one of the tools we assume we can rely on, I think it's important to realize that it could, I mean, we pointed all the arrows at it, that it could be wrong, right? And here, it's done the 22% thing rather than the 88% thing, right? The 78% thing. Here we've got a situation where, in fact, the scenario isn't going to work. It's picked up on something and it thinks it's right.
How do you know? It looks right.
Exactly. So as you run through this scenario, you'll inevitably find that this scenario is wrong. And you've got to test it. You've got to accept what it's doing, go through the process, check, validate it, put tests around it. And then you're going to get to realize that it's another tool. And just like you go to that blog post of that one person that's excellent, and sometimes it works for you and sometimes it doesn't, you should simply ask the question again. Like,
but
ask the question again.
Whose fault is it that it didn't say, it's a beautiful day, let's go to the museum?
Probability and non-determinism. It's just, it's ultimately, the issue here is that it's never going to give you necessarily the same response twice. And you've got to follow what you know logically about the code. It's going to be something that you help with, but not something you end with, ultimately.
I'm glad that it didn't work.
Yeah.
Because it's important for these kind of things for you to understand that just because it works in a demo doesn't mean it's always going to work for you.
Yeah, yeah.
We saw before that like beach might be 70%. In this case, you said this is the 22%.
Yeah, yeah.
You just made that number up.
Yeah, yeah.
But in this case, it's this is problematic, by the way. It's confidently wrong.
Right. So, and that's part of the grounding. And you know, there's a balance we have to get to, where we assume that you want to have something that sounds relatively confident. We can make your assistant do that. We can make your assistant seem like, this is an answer, but I'm really not sure if it's even correct.
Okay.
Right? The question is, what is the balance?
So how do we recover from this now? Because you're saying as a professional programmer of many years, you know that that's wrong.
Yes.
Can you tell it that that's wrong and have it try again?
So you can provide feedback on any response you get. That's something that is incredibly helpful as we move in that way. But ultimately, like I said, when you're at the top of the funnel of some kind of diagnostics, you hope to eliminate a few things and go down a path. You check if the path is good. If it's not, you go back to the top and check some more things. So I'm going to basically go back to the top of the path and check some more things again.
That's great.
So let's go ahead and...
I've been having this conversation with my son as he's been applying to colleges, and he keeps telling me if he wants to run, if he's allowed to run his college essay through ChatGPT. And I keep trying to remind him that ChatGPT has never gone to college before. You are the one going to college, right? We need to make sure that we are able to decide for ourselves what's right and what's wrong, and having that critical thinking skill is super important. This is a tool. It's a spanner. We need to decide what we're going to do with it. Okay, so you've returned back to the exception there, and you've said ask again.
Yep.
Okay, so you're looking through your reference material. You've re-asked it.
Yep.
And are you hoping it's going to get it right again?
Yes, I'm hoping again that the first response is going to be correct.
Okay.
Again, please check the serialized method. That's exactly
okay,
what I'm...
Okay, so then tell it it's empty.
Okay. Serialized...
I'm going to get you turned on to dictation. I don't type anymore, man. I'm always talking to the thing.
It is empty.
Is empty.
All right, let's see if that...
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it's asking me now, serialized is empty. It's asking me specifically about the other method that is further up the call stack.
Mm.
It's saying to JSON might be an issue. Can I have a look at what...
So it had JSON? A different idea.
Yes.
To be clear, you asked it the same thing.
Same
you
question.
Typed serialized is empty. It said non-deterministic.
Yeah.
It is not 100% going to say the same thing.
So I'm going to jump across here really quickly. And here is the toJSON. I'm going to go ahead and give it that selection.
So you're telling it about that chunk of code, and you're saying,
yep.
Hey, this is the thing. It has an opinion.
It has something to say. Ha, interesting. So it's basically saying we did something wrong in 2JSON. It's looked at 2JSON and said, hey, you're not resetting the stream. It's one line. It's a weird one. And I'm going to preview that.
Do you think you could have found that on your own? Or is this going to... This is
I
a time saver.
I absolutely would not have found that on my own.
Okay.
I absolutely would not have found
so this
that
is
on
what,
my
this
own.
So this is a head-banging problem.
Absolutely. So I'm going to go ahead and accept that. And pull that in.
It even wrote a little comment for you.
Yep. Reset the stream here.
And then our remaining minute, we'll see if we can stick the landing.
Actually, yes. See, test explorer.
No pressure, brother.
Run.
Go.
If it turns green.
Yo. Nailed it.
Yeah.
This is the coder equivalent of like, he needs this for a birdie. Oh, yes. Good job.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, for the non-technical in the room, they're like, I don't know, the red dot is now a green dot. But that is a combination of the co-pilot, which helped us, and the professional developer who knows better, making it happen. I want to thank you all for spending time with us. We've got a bunch of exciting stuff happening at Ignite. I want to encourage you, of course, to sign up for these features. If you want to get this co-pilot chat preview, you can take a look at these URLs, or take a picture of that URL right there. Certainly you can go out and Google with Bing and learn more. We appreciate you all, and thank you so much for spending time with us today.